y es un emprendedor desde los 25 años. Un aplauso para Gary Wallman, por favor.
Testing, testing. Oh, I guess the clicker was going, wasn't it? Funny. How's everybody doing? Good? Yeah? 20,000 people, huh? Broke a world record. Give yourselves a round of applause. Come on. Right? You know, it's truly been an honor. So that all of you know, I've been with the Campus Party family now for almost 3 years. And it's truly been an honor to see how this platform has grown from what Paco started almost 20 years ago. I gave my first keynote here in 2014, talking about the future of entrepreneurship. Last year, the talk that I gave was on the secrets of the world's most successful companies. And today we're gonna talk about smart cities and the future and how to build the future from both bottom up and top down. Our planet and our world, we have 7.4 billion people on this planet, and we're just kind of a big sea of humanity. We're making our way through our mundane lives thinking that everything is going to be kind of okay. But the thing about technology, folks, is you're becoming immune to what's happening in you, around you, and with you. Where we exist on our own islands, and it might seem a little bit idyllic, but the fact of the matter is, if you're just seeking the obvious, if you're just seeking the obvious in life, you're one of the ones who is truly oblivious. Because there is a global tsunami coming. The bad news is, it's going to disrupt your family, your friends, your communities, your nations, even your countries. The good news is, in this presentation, is the final keynote of this amazing week-long event series that you've had here at Campus Party Mexico 2016, is we're gonna anchor your understanding of what a tsunami is, what it's all about, and how you can not just survive, but actually thrive. Because the fact of the matter is, my friends, that unstable opportunities are the most positive opportunity to make impact, because opportunities, in case you haven't noticed, are something that are all around us. Because unstable opportunities create incredible times. The interesting thing about a tsunami is how vast the impact actually is. How many of you have ever witnessed a tsunami? Raise your hand. Anybody? Less than 5 people in an audience of a couple hundred people. Well, the interesting thing about a tsunami is not only is it a destructive force that obliterates everything in its path, what it also does is take a tectonic shift to how the world actually works. And its ripples bow out all across the entire world. If you remember in Indonesia in 2005, those ripple effects were felt all the way as far as Hawaii. And today the same thing is true, my friends, because technology is neither good nor bad. What technology does is it accelerates intent. Technology is nothing more than platforms that accelerate intent. And with that in mind, nobody is immune from the impact of what's coming. These are just some of the instances of what's been going on, right? We'll go back in history a little bit. In 2000 was the dot-com bubble. 2005 is when the bankers started playing a Ponzi scheme with real estate. By 2008, the world imploded, right? So in 2011, what did that cause? That caused Occupy Wall Street. That caused Middle East uprisings because the bankers were playing funny again already 3 years later. They were spiking food prices. What did that cause? Caused the rise of violent extremism. I think we've all heard of ISIS and some of these other radical groups, right? And so what did that cause, my friends? Caused mass migration, right? Caused mass migration. I just spoke at the Oslo Freedom Forum, spent time with some of the folks who are bogged down in Raqqa, Syria, trying to make a difference, trying to keep hope alive. And the thing is, in the midst of what they're going through in their families, is their friends are fleeing, just trying to live. What we're starting to see is xenophobia. And we're starting to see xenophobia because we don't understand each other. We're being forced to understand each other faster than we are allowing, faster than we understand how. So we have protests, which give rise to folks like Donald Trump. And Donald Trump and far right-wing leaders give rise to things like Brexit. And if you think Brexit is the end, my friends, Brexit is just the beginning of what's coming. And I think you understand what I'm talking about because we are here in Mexico, right? What I actually love about Donald Trump is that Donald Trump reflects what America is. Loud, obnoxious, clueless, demographically homogeneous, and in a lot of ways, judgmental, right? And in that way, what we're starting to see all around the world is the worst side of people. Technology is actually accelerating xenophobia. Instead of us standing up and coming together and making sure that unstable times create incredible opportunities, what we actually have is folks like Donald Trump who bring in a new brand of nationalism. So you have to admit, the world every day is looking a little bit darker. I was just in Dhaka, Bangladesh last year. Dhaka, Bangladesh is a country roughly 6 times the size of Guadalajara, and it has 180 million people in it. Think about that for a second. 6 times the size of Guadalajara, and there's 180 million people in it. If any of you have watched the news, I think you know what happened in Dhaka yesterday, for instance, which is a very well-known cafe, and I had actually been to that cafe last fall. We're even at a point where we're starting to ask ourselves this question. Think about that for a moment, folks. Think how irrational the world is right now that we have to think about the future has now become a perceived threat instead of an unbridled opportunity to create what we're passionate about. Right? It doesn't have to be that way, because the good news is humanity has come a long way. What controlled the world was people dependent on structures. Tiananmen Square is a perfect example. Right? The structures were imposed upon us, and then we started standing up and coming together. Right? This is the formula of what was imposed upon us. We were regulated by structure, process, and control. It is what we are moving beyond in the 21st century, my friends. For the first time ever, we have the full opportunity to leverage our human ingenuity to transcend the systems that have held us back for so long. The funny thing is, we think we're so smart that we've already figured out the formula for how to build a 21st century city. It's premised on the belief that you take infrastructure, basic infrastructure, you take lots of technology and you just throw it everywhere, and then you just need humans. So you put humans with a bunch of resources and events, and you just put it in a pot and you mix it all together, and after that it's magically just going to work. But the way the future that we're eagerly planning and building, my friends, is giving us a false sense of security. As we launch ourselves into the second decade of a new century, we have this unwritten credo that's pushing us forward, that technology is always good, that technology is always going to work, that all we need is more and more and more technology. Well, we don't just need more technology, my friends, because the belief that technology is going to save humanity is a half-truth. Anybody that tells you technology by itself is going to save humanity is 50% lying to you. Let me give you some examples. You have environment that's devolving into exploitation, right? You have government that's devolving into dictatorship. You have medicine and healthcare that's now all of a sudden devolving into sick care. And finally, last but not least, what you're seeing is the financialization of business, where you're seeing business just devolve into making more money for the sake of money's sake, for the sake of more money for rich people. What each of these causes is a tsunami, in and of themselves and together. And the more each of those interconnected forces in each of those interconnected industries leverage technology and continue to devolve, the bigger the tsunami that's about to come. So the question is, what's really going on today? Well, what's really going on today is that cities, instead of allowing us to stand up and come together and harness the energy that we have as human beings, the creativity, the human ingenuity, what it's actually doing, we're creating cities that just have infrastructure and smartphones. And in the process, we're losing out on the very thing that matters most to us, the most abundant resource that we have as human beings, my friends, which is human ingenuity. We're being swallowed up. Whether it's a human ocean in the crazy streets of Dhaka, Bangladesh, which that is a picture from when I was there last fall, or it's more the planned people grids, like a New York City, where there's process and a little bit more structured chaos instead of unorganized and disruptive chaos. Right? The thing is, supposedly we're together, right? How many of you use the internet? Raise your hand. I don't see anybody unless they're sleeping like the guy in the front row. That's kind of funny. Oh, he woke up. Give him a round of applause. He woke up. Yeah, he's been coding all week. Give the guy a break. There we go. Give the guy a break. He's been coding all week, right? The thing is, look, we've been tapping away at our keyboards, right? All week. We tap away, tap away, tap away. But keyboards give us a false sense of security. They give us a false sense of distance, and they also give us a false sense of connectedness. Let me say that again. Keyboards and screens give you a false sense of distance, a false sense of connectedness, and a false sense of security. Because although we're together online, we've never been more isolated behind our screens. In fact, I just came from Africa. I spent a lot of time on the continent, particularly in Ghana, Nigeria, and South Africa. And the thing is, I just was on the radio show, a friend of mine, Bernard Alvey, and I was talking about digital colonialization. Because the fact of the matter is, my friends, all Wall Street, all Silicon Valley has become is the Wall Street of the West. What they're doing is they're taking bags and bags of money, and they're rolling up eyeballs into just a couple pipes. Amazon, Facebook, Google, Alibaba, and one or two others. They're going back to walled gardens and portals. They're building a digital colonialization instead of a physical colonialization. And if you don't understand that, going back to what I said before, if you're just looking for the obvious, holy cow, you can access the internet and all this information. Well, you're actually oblivious because you're missing out on what's really going on. And it doesn't need to be that way. That's why we're going to talk about cities. Because humans reflect cities and cities reflect humans. Right? There's no such thing as a city or a state or even a company without all of us. They're just abstract concepts. Right? You need humans to have companies. You need humans to have cities. You need humans to have states, and you need humans to have nations. The thing is, when Rousseau said this, he was talking about our ever-increasing urban sprawls and concrete jungles. What he was warning us about was that we were being sucked into something that wasn't humanity, wasn't natural. We are nature, and nature is us, right? There's a very real danger and a very real threat in the 21st century that we're living in right now. And most of you don't even know it. My job on this stage here is to give you another chance, another opportunity to look into yourself and out into the abyss and choose different. To look again at what you're thinking, what you're planning, what you're doing. To use the reality of now to transcend those systems and those structures and just those screens that many of you are staring at right now aimlessly. My job is to show you how to grab hold of the tsunami and use it as an opportunity to catapult forward from where you are now towards a better and brighter future. So we're going to talk about five trends. These are the five biggest trends of the future that you need to understand. Whether it's for yourself, your family, your community, a company that you want to build, or whether you want to think more about your city, whether you're passionate about your country. These are the five trends that matter. We're going to go through them one by one right now. Discuss each and every one. The first trend you need to understand is that power is being decentralized. We are gaining new avenues for direct access because we have hyper-connected people, data, and infrastructure. For the first time in hundreds of years, we have direct access to information, to others, to resources. For so long, we've been stuck in between at the whims of the middlemen and systems. Direct access, what that does, folks, is it breeds choice. Some of the things and some of the trends that you're seeing right now that are byproducts of the choice that we now have are crowdsourcing, on-demand convenience, direct consumerism. But the point I want all of you to take away from this slide and why decentralized forms of power matter is that systems today in the 21st century are irrelevant. Networks are what matters. If you're structured as a system, you will die. The reason why is because of the second trend, which is the evolution of networks. What we need to embrace is networks, because today, actually, let me break this down really simply for all you folks. Today, where we are as a human species, and what is going to decide whether a billion people die as a direct result of what's coming within the next 10 years or not, is really simple. You have networks and you have systems. Right now, we have social networks. Right? Instagram, Facebook, we can connect anytime, anywhere, any place for any intent. The problem is, over here what we have is systems. Top-down hierarchical structures of command and control. And we have political systems, and we have economic systems. So you have social networks, but you have political and economic systems. And until political and economic systems become political and economic networks, my friends, Brexit is just the start of what you're about to see in this world. And here's why. Because as human beings, we are all creators. All we want is more collaborative possibility. We have more connectivity. We have means for direct access, which brings choice. All we want is an ability to create what we're all passionate about. That's at the root of every human being. What we're all looking for is a shared sense of a couple things, to transition those systems to networks. Right? We want shared policy frameworks. We want shared infrastructure. We want shared economies. And lastly, and most importantly, we want shared consumption. Right? Networks are what drives accountability. Folks, the reason why bankers get away with what they get away with, The reason why politicians get away with what they get away with, the reason psychopathic CEOs get away with what they get away with, is because we have political and business systems, not political and business networks. And that's where we need to go. If you want accountability, push for a network. Don't just get out in the streets and think that's going to solve anything, because that's actually a pretty clueless thing to do. What you're asking people to do is connect with intention. Connecting with intention brings the third trend, which is the rise of community. What we need is accountability within the networks in the 21st century. Accountability and shared values is when community actually begins to emerge. Community in our families, in our companies, in our communities. This is what we're always looking for. We are always looking for community. When you have a shared sense of who you are and what you're trying to do with other people, what emerges is a new rule book, right? A new rule book for the 21st century of how you're going to build community. Because it's not just about money. I can tell you that much. There's a new rule book for how we collaborate. There's also a new rule book for putting purpose at the center. How many of you have heard of Simon Sinek? His book, Start With Why. I recommend that all of you read it. What's your passion? What's your purpose? What's your cause? What's your belief? That's what Simon talks about in his book. How many of you have heard of Steve Jobs? Raise your hand. Right? How many of you have heard of James Cameron? Raise your hand. At the root of any of the successful people that are normally the icons that you follow is passion, purpose, cause, and belief. That's why starting with why matters, and that's why Simon wrote that book. Recommend that each of you read it. Because in every rising community, in terms, will shape its own rule book in the 21st century. We have our own collective credo of how we want to live. I'll give you an example. When I spend time in Africa, there's an African Union, right? Now, who are the delegates in the African Union, this political system that they have on a continent of 1.1 billion people? Well, it's a bunch of 40 and 50 and 60-year-old men and women who think they know better than the millennial generation of where the world is going and why. The biggest challenge in Africa is rule number one in the military playbook, divide and conquer. What Africa needs is a sense of purpose, vision, and values, so that the millennial generation, all a half billion of them, can stand up and come together as Africans. That's why I put up this picture. This is from the Solidarity Memorial in Poland, from the shipyards. I was there just a month and a half ago. I go there twice a year, every year, to spend time with my friends and their families, because that is the place where communism first fell, where the community and the vision for a higher sense of transcendent purpose and opportunity was so powerful that they wrote down a set of principles on a board in pencil and would not move until that happened. All they were asking for was connectivity towards something better, bigger, brighter. All they were asking for was to be connected. The 21st century is the same. And the thing is, the rule book when it comes to starting communities is that isolation kills. If you think living on an island is what's going to help you to survive, if you think building walls instead of bridges, if you think hating instead of loving is what's going to make the world a better place, or going to help you to be happier, healthier, or have an ability to take care of your family, you're dead wrong. Underline dead. The fourth trend is the trust of tribes. It's not enough that we're just connected. In communities, it's those shared values that are the glue that help us to stand up and come together, to get that transcendent purpose. Trust is the confidence of cooperative intention. Trust is what brings exponential opportunity. You hear a lot of folks talk about exponential technology. How many people actually talk about exponential opportunity and give you a rule book for how to actually get and attain exponential opportunity? I've never seen anybody. That's why I travel the world, continent by continent, studying how to give human beings opportunity. Because cooperative intention is what matters in the 21st century, because technology will continue to accelerate at an exponential pace. But the thing we have to remember is that we are all human beings first. Because to save humanity, we have to remember that we're human beings first and foremost. We forget that. In our daily lives, in our mundane lives, staring at these screens, we have such narrow visions of what matters, right? And we don't do it on purpose. It's the technology that's supposedly doing it for us, right? I love it when people say that technology shapes us, and then we shape technology. Because actually what's going on is technology is being imposed on you in shaping you, in directing you. Because the technology is being imposed on you through walled gardens. Right? Just about all of you either have an Apple or an Android. There's a reason why. Sure, it gives you opportunity, maybe. But not for everybody. Life is not about limitless data and smart screens, my friends. What life is about, is about being happy. It's about being healthy. And it's about having an ability to take care of your family. How many of you agree that those three things matter to you? Raise your hand. I've traveled to more than 60 countries around the world. That is the universal pattern of what every human being cares about. And as long as you can do those three things, there's no reason to have a Brexit. There's no reason to have an Occupy Wall Street. Right? And the reason that matters is because distrust destroys possibility. The reason you see Brexit, the reason you see Occupy Wall Street, the reason you see protests in the Middle East, is because people just want to be happy, healthy, and take care of their family. And the systems that are in place impose their will on people instead of people being able to stand up and come together as they seek to do. And why does that matter? Because for the first time in human history, 21st century cities are global. It's kind of a long formula, but it's true. Decentralization is a fancy way to say you have direct access and opportunity. For the first time ever, we have direct access and opportunity. We're starting to structure as networks. We're also learning how to communicate in communities and have trust that binds us together. But this environment is not bound by state lines, by country lines anymore, by regional affiliations. It's truly global. Networks are what builds inclusive cities. Networks are what build inclusive countries. Networks are what makes sure that you are happy, healthy, and have the ability to take care of your family. Human ingenuity thrives when we're able to live, work, and play. And in the 21st century, that's taking a whole new form, right? For the boomers and the Xers, how they feel meaning and value is very separate than the millennial generation and Generation Z. The boomers and the Xers feel value by listening to commands and following orders. I'm a millennial, and folks under the age of 18 are Generation Z. And how they feel value is by changing something for collective interest, by changing something for the better, and by being more inclusive. So think about those two very disparate ways that four separate generations think. And there's a huge chasm in between the boomers and the Xers and the millennials and Generation Z. The great thing about living and working and playing in the 21st century, and particularly in the next 10 years, is the boomers and the Xers get older and retire, more of us millennials will be able to stand up and come together in political networks, in economic networks, and in social networks to change so that we can be more inclusive. Because what really you need to understand, folks, is anytime somebody talks about a system and anybody talks just about technology by itself, Be weary of half-truths, because half-truths are what is the threat. Because half-truths in a borderless world are what makes sure that a billion people die within the next decade. The opportunity we all have here is to embrace that creative energy, that bountiful creative energy for why all of you are here. 20,000 of us are here because each of us are creators. Each of us believe in a better future for our families, for our friends, for our loved ones, for the ideas that we have, the visions that we have, whatever they may be, small or big, right? So let's do a recap real quick. Talking about humans deserve better. Folks, the world needs change. It's not a matter of whether change is coming. It's a matter of what type of gift package the change comes in, okay? The waves of change are already hitting us hard, right? But even in those unstable times when we do face destruction, what we have is an unbridled opportunity that's never existed before. It's our mission here today, July 2nd, 2016, is our mission to make better choices. Because in the end, what I believe, what I truly believe, is that humans deserve better. How many of you believe that humans deserve better? Raise your hand. That's exactly right. We do deserve better. The question all of us have, whether you're starting a family, whether you're building a company, whether you're deciding what next to do in life, how do we drive change? Change is anchored in four strategies. And even though the world we live in is about to get hit by a tsunami, and there's going to be a lot of chaos, the difference is we have an opportunity this time to thrive. Because within human ingenuity, we have the power to transcend. And it's in inclusive cities in the 21st century that will make the difference. Because by 2025, 60% of 7.4 billion human beings will live in cities. 60% of 7.4 billion human beings. And just so we're clear why that matters, only 4.1 billion of us right now have access to the internet. Let me say that again. The largest community for technology is not online yet. Think about that. Think about those implications. Think about how that's going to drive change in the next 10 years. So let's talk about four future-ready strategies. Four strategies that will help you drive better outcomes personally, professionally, with your family, your friends, your communities. This is what I call my future-ready formula. What we're going to talk about is four separate steps, first starting with directed innovation. Directed innovation is the forward motion of creation. Creation is just harnessing unbridled human ingenuity, the most abundant force that we have in the universe. Right? When you evaluate your smart city plans, what matters is understanding how to build momentum, how to build in co-creation and inclusive platforms. Because at the end of the day, that's how cities actually evolve. Common sense, right? Because humans make cities, and cities are human. They are living. They are breathing. They are something that can be metricized, just like a spreadsheet, just like nature. Cities are a distributed network. What cities need more than ever is urban commuter strategies that are inclusive for all of us. Because in those cities, we're all trying to make a collective contribution. We all want shared control. We don't want to be told what to do. As millennials and Generation Z, we do not want to be told what to do, ever. What we want to do is have a discussion. What we want to do is have a discussion about how more people can win together for a bigger, brighter, and more inclusive future. What we care about is making sure that we capitalize on what we all agreed on already in this audience, that humans do deserve better. And that's why what we have to remember is that we all have to have a plan for micro-specialization. In the 21st century, each of us is passionate about something. You might wanna build a treehouse. You might wanna start a software company. You might wanna be a vocalist. Whatever you wanna do, focus on that first. Money is not a goal. Money is a byproduct of doing what you're passionate about, having the right strategies to execute on it, with the right vision, with the right time, with a set of principled resources that all boil up into an opportunity that then make a living. It doesn't magically just come out of the heavens. Bags of money does just not come out of the heavens. I hate to break it to you. And that's why what matters is planned technology. Because technology at this point, my friends, while most of you take pictures with them right now, what you need to understand is that technology is dangerous. It can be dangerous. That phone, that iPad that's in your hand, is something that can free you or enslave you. It's something that can connect you to everybody and to nobody. It's something that can colonize your mind or free your mind. And you have to make that choice. And nobody else can make that choice but you. In Africa, they need technology more than anywhere else in the world because of the lack of basic infrastructure that they have. They actually have to leapfrog their infrastructure problems with technology and build infrastructure after using and leveraging technology. But just so we're clear on what technology is, and I said this once before, technology is nothing more than a platform that accelerates intent, okay? What the technologists like to tell you is that your phones and your computers, that's all that technology means. Oh, I hate to break it to you, it doesn't. A car helps you accelerate where you're trying to go and why you're trying to go there. That's technology, right? A toilet that you hopefully sit on at least once every day or two to get rid of what we all have to do as basic human beings accelerates in intent, which is get rid of some things, right? That's technology too. And I really want you folks to understand that. Because the next time somebody gives you this overarching statement of technology, ask them what they mean by that. Qualify that statement. Make a choice to critically think about who you're getting advice from when they use the word technology. Because technology can free you or it can enslave you. Technology is what's redefining our physical world. And the reason why is because it's uprooting and it's eradicating and it's transforming so many of the basic fundamental things that have been in place for thousands and millions of years, right? For the first time ever, we don't have businesses in the Fortune, the S&P 500 that are living more than a decade, right? The S&P 500, the average rate that somebody stays on there, a company stays on there, is less than a decade for the first time in history. And the reason why is technology, because of the rapid change. And as responsible human beings who understand that technology has to be planned for after the opportunity to create an innovation is given to us, which is a responsibility in and of itself, what we have to remember is that things like virtual learning and telemedicine are the types of things that will allow us to have a bigger and a brighter future. But they have to come in at the right time for the right reasons. Third, shared values. Shared values is something we all need right now. Because when the wave hits, the only way you're going to survive is if you have your neighbor's back. Community is what makes the impossible more probable for 7.4 billion human beings. Let me say that again. Shared values, what you believe, is what makes the impossible more probable for all of us as a species. And in the next 10 years, that's going to matter more than ever. By coming together, we can enable the creative solutions that we all need. We can pull together so that every single human being, all 7.4 billion of us, have an opportunity to craft our own survival story. Nobody should craft that for you. Nobody should craft that for you. So how do you make sure that happens? We're just going to talk about some basic universal truths real quick. They seem simple, and they are, but they're not very easy. It's not very easy to always be respectful, right? Easy to say, hard to do. See beyond yourself. It's real easy just to look at yourself all the time. Think about numero uno. Think about just your family. Let me give you this example, my friends. What happens if tomorrow money was worthless? What if tomorrow you didn't have safe drinking water? What if tomorrow you couldn't just drive down the road because there were no roads anymore? How would you survive? What would happen? In the majority of countries around the world, when money becomes worthless, and it will, you're going to see brutal civil war. In countries around the world, roughly about 60% of the earth that's going to have a water crisis within the next 20 years, there's going to be a civil war. And last but not least, when infrastructure isn't built, infrastructure that gives us an opportunity to connect, there will be civil war. But there doesn't need to be, because we can all pull together. We can all pull together because every single one of us raised our hands about humans deserving better, because we all believe in better real-world solutions. We all believe in helping one another. My friends, being here this week, you have 20,000 brothers and sisters and friends, people who believe what you believe in some way, shape, or form. It's up to you to capitalize on that opportunity, to talk about what your truth is, not just what your business title is. Nobody cares about what you do. They care about why you do it. And they care about that because they want to know if they can trust you. They want to know if you're accountable. Because in the 21st century, whether you live, whether your family lives, whether you die, whether your family dies, whether your business accelerates or it dies, the fulcrum is going to be accountability. How willing are you to have courage to look in the mirror? How willing are you as a startup founder to realize that what's in the best interest of your company is not always in the best interest of you? Let me say that again. As a founder, what's in the best interest of your company sometimes, somewhere, will not be in your own best interest. And it's up to you to decide, what are you going to choose? You have to plan. You have to plan for service bartering. It was funny, I was on the way back from South Africa talking to a gentleman who just sold his company. And we were talking about the fact of how we built our global companies. He was in the payment processing space, and I built one of the largest global networks for entrepreneurs in the world when I was 25. How we built our companies was never raising money from a venture capitalist, because venture capitalists, they're in the business of making money for money's sake for rich people. They don't care about your vision. They care about your vision only if it makes them richer. Right? What we talked about is the fact that we never raised money. What we did is we built a premium product at a premium price, and every time we sold something, we reinvested that cash flow. And we scaled in something magically called organic. Just like organic food is good for you and healthy for you, organic scale is good for you and healthy for you, my friends. Trust me. The only way you can scale organically is to barter, to take what you're the best in the world at, whatever that is, and partner. But you have to be able to step past that screen that you put in your face. You have to go to networking events and talk about what you believe and be vulnerable. You have to decide to make a difference that only you can make. Another thing we're starting to see is co-living situations. Right? What we love to do as a millennial generation is work, live, play, all in the same type of space. Because as a millennial and as Generation Z, there's no difference between working and living and playing for us. We don't do something we don't see as a lifestyle. What we do is a lifestyle choice. There's no difference between work and live. We don't live to work. We work to live. Think about that. Anybody above 40 years old, for the most part, not everybody, thinks about living to work, not working to live. Your parents do have your best interest in mind when they want you to just go get a job. When they tell you it's a lot safer, when they tell you you're 26, 27, 28, and you need to start taking care of the family, because that's what they did. You find that here in Mexico. That's the same thing you find in the Middle East. It's the same thing you also find on the continent of Africa too. Right? But there's a way to move forward. Also through co-business spaces. As millennials and Generation Z, we have a responsibility to help the boomers, to help our parents understand that we think differently, that we live differently, that we work differently. And it's up to you to help them understand, because they're not going to understand otherwise, right? Whether it's your mother, your father, your brother, your sister, your boss, they won't understand unless you take the time to help them understand. Why does that matter? Because, my friends, at the root of what we're all seeking, the way in which to achieve humans deserving better is inclusive justice. Inclusive justice is when everybody in humanity can participate in whatever they're passionate about. The reason we see extremism, the reason we see so many crazy things like Brexit happening, is because of structural violence. Because the structures, the systems themselves, literally create violence. And in the 21st century, what networks allow us to do, if we take the opportunity that we're talking about, is have a more inclusive future. Because you don't get justice through anarchy. You get it through shared mission, vision, and values. Anybody can pick up a gun. It takes courage to look somebody in the eye and tell them you love them. Anybody can build a wall. It takes courage to sit down with somebody who you disagree with and respectfully understand where they're coming from and find a solution. My friends, this is what inclusive justice means. For so long, we've been stuck in a state where fear, ego, and despair is what drove our actions. For the first time ever, we have connectivity, opportunity, and abundance that can drive our decisions instead. But it's the transparency that matters. The folks who also like to talk about technology are also the ones who you'll find aren't very transparent, right? We won't get too far into what those walled gardens actually are, but if you do your research on just about anybody who's a tech enthusiast, find out how transparent they actually are about their personal and professional lives. Because that's what they want from all of us, right? They want to know everything about you. Where you work, where you live, what you like, what you do, all the time, every minute, every second. Whether you're living, dead, sleeping, anything. They want that transparency from you. Do we see that from our political systems? Do we see that from our companies and the CEOs? Do we see that from the presidents of our countries? No, we don't. It's kind of ironic, isn't it? So what do you need to plan for? You need to plan for accountability. One of the most amazing websites to me in India, India has a very systemic and structurally violent corruption problem. They have a website called ipaytobribe.com. I think this website, the concept of it, could do something very similar to what's happened in India for Mexico. The site's been up only just a couple years. There's been 18,000 reports generated of people who actually didn't take a bribe. Think about that. The site isn't just about folks who took a bribe. It's also about folks who didn't take a bribe. That's something that could be very helpful and very useful, especially in a place like Mexico. You also have to plan for community justice ideals. Remember when I was talking just about Africa, about the millennial generation standing up and coming together? That's the reason why I helped co-found a platform called African Global Leaders. Because the idea is the fact that the boomers and folks like our parents don't understand what we as millennials and Generation Z are looking for. What we as millennials want is our own collective credo for what we want our future to be. And in Africa, in the next 20 years, that means roughly a billion folks under the age of 30 being able to stand up and come together and write their future. It's the same opportunity that Mexicans have for Mexico and Central America as well. And what I want to make clear to you folks, when it comes to inclusive justice and those four strategies, being in the middle, it's true, it is the safest place to be, but it's also where the least amount of impact is actually made. The more you build walls, the more you stay isolated, the more you decide not to connect, the more you decide to judge, the more mentally, physically, emotionally, and spiritually you will die in the 21st century. Whether it's you, your family, your community, your company, your cities, or your country. Folks, it's not a matter of how and when the tsunami is coming. You can't be afraid to seek opportunity as the chaos comes and is already here. What we need to understand is that the world, when the tsunami comes, needs to be planned and rebuilt around what we want, because we all believe that humans deserve better. It needs to be planned and rebuilt around what we need, because we all believe that humans deserve better. And we all need to plan and rebuild the right way, because human ingenuity deserves it. But it's about momentum, and it's about getting moving. So I'm going to leave you with three quick ways you can jump on your surfboard and ride the wave instead of having the wave crash directly into you. Because maybe some of you in the audience today want to take the safe option, and that's okay if you want to. I'm not up on this stage because I want to take the safe option. I'm not up here talking to you because I want to take the safe option. I'm up here because change happens on the edges of where we're comfortable. I'm up here because change happens when you have the courage to look in the mirror. There are three actions you can take to make sure that you're future ready. The first, go find your community. We know that the future of cities will revolve around vast populations. Like I said, 60% of 7.4 billion human beings will live in cities by 2025. The real art of 21st century living is wrapped around hundreds of thousands of small microcosm communities where we live and work and play together. They're connected by shared values. You won't just have one job or one career. Most of us already sitting in this room have probably had 2, 3, 4, or 5. But you have to start now finding your community. You have to immerse yourself and surround yourself with people who believe what you believe, whatever that may be, right? Because the people that surround you are what matter most. You are a direct reflection of the 7 to 10 people you spend the most time with. And I will guarantee you, if you wrote down right now what you want written on your tombstone, what the biggest vision you have for yourself is in your life, for the world, I will guarantee you 1 to 2 of those people probably wouldn't support you as much as you need them to. The opportunity that you have after today is to make a choice, to find that community that will support you to whatever extent you see, you believe. how you want to write your story for how humans deserve better, how your family deserves better, how your friends deserve better. Remember that when the chaos comes, it's community, family, friends, loved ones, or what is going to make the difference. Second, don't get caught up in the half-truths. If you do anything, if you learned anything from this presentation, I beg you, folks, please, do not fall for the half-truths. They are manipulative truths. They manipulate you by design. Trust me. I'll give you an example. How many of you have heard of Silicon Valley? Right. Most folks have heard of Silicon Valley. And most folks think that Silicon Valley is just about startups, just about innovation. My friends, Silicon Valley is the preeminent national defense strategy of the United States of America. It is not an economic strategy. It's not even technically a political strategy. It is a military strategy. There's a reason why those phones and those laptops that you have sitting in your laps that you use right now, the majority of that technology all comes from an organization called DARPA. That organization is essentially the venture capital arm of the national defense of the United States of America. It's interesting, isn't it? So what are you going to choose? Are you going to choose to light your candle by yourself or with others who believe in something more, who believe in networks, not systems, who believe that humans deserve better, not just sacrifice of the many for the few elites? Smart cities that survive the change that's coming put people first, just as we do with ourselves and our families. And last but not least, if there's one more thing that I hope you take away from this presentation, my friends, the best and last time to wake up is here now. The best time was to wake up before. The best and next time, and the last time, is right now. Everything I've talked about, I have a couple books coming out on community, leadership, and justice in the 21st century. You can follow me anytime. I respond to emails, gary@garywhitehill.com. Follow me on Twitter, @GaryWhitehill. Whatever I can do to help catapult you, I am here for you. Thank you very much for your time. I appreciate all of you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much. Thank you. Questions. Can't wait to see what random questions we get. We only get two. They scream loud over there. Sorry.
Thank you. So English, right? So you speak...
Yeah, habla un poco español.
No, don't worry, English, right? So you just speak a lot about this half-truth, this technology enthusiast. They're the transhumanisms. I've seen some stuff about that. Transhumanism. Some guy was talking about that before, so...
Sure.
I want to ask you a question. I know you know and what you know. What's the opposite to that transhumanism? Because that's an official agenda, like the military strategy.
Yeah.
So it will lead us to one result, but that's not the best result we need as humans, right? So what's the opposite to transhumanism?
That's a phenomenal question. And it's a scary question, right? Because what we're sold is just clones. We can clone, you can live forever now, right? You can just mutate genes, right? And it's just always going to be a positive thing, right? Because you can mutate any gene for yourself, or if you're going to have a baby, and that means you're going to have better kids. Have you ever heard of movies like Equilibrium, The Giver, Snowpiercer, The Matrix, Hunger Games? I can keep going down the list. There's about 13 to 15 films that all talk about what happens when technology is just thrown up in the air and people are allowed to use it unbridledly, without shared mission, vision, values, and inclusive purpose that all of us can decide. Let me be clear. Most human beings are phenomenal people, right? But whether you're dirt poor or you're super rich, and everybody in between, 3.5% of all human beings who are born are psychopaths. They are statistical anomalies. 3.5% of all human beings are those types of folks that all of us, I don't think, want that type of technology in their hands. The only way, the best way, and the last way in the 21st century we're gonna make sure that things like what you're worried about and I'm worried about don't happen is everything we just talked about, particularly community and particularly values. Because like I said, my friend, when we talk about technology and technology genomes and hacking genomes, ask somebody, what do you mean by that, three times in a row? See if they talk about anything that I just did in this presentation. Shared mission, vision, values, passion, purpose, cause, belief, inclusive justice, right? Planned technology, shared values. See if they say any of those words. I will guarantee you they won't. I will guarantee you they won't. All right, time for one more question. I'm sorry. We got to do three, because I got to get somebody over there. But we'll get you first. You got to catch the ball, though.
Yes, like you were saying that we should have the same values and that we should reach to our communities. But like with the Brexit right now and what's going on with the United States and since we're their neighbors and all, and I see that all the people is like so scared.
Yeah.
And you were saying that we should focus on the values. But do you think that that mindset can be really shared and people just stop, they can stop being afraid, saying like, I don't want immigrants here. This is my country and I should take care only of my own. And I see that countries like Norway, they do pretty well and they are just their own economy. And they don't need like the European Union
right.
to have, you know, more countries to be together.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you think there's a way, like, I see Norway is fine, yeah. and I'm glad for them, but do you think that's really like the way to go? They might I guess they have their values and they're doing pretty well, but I see like everybody is like being selfish and just my country. And I understand your point of view, but do you think there's really a way that we can lose that fear and really think maybe in a, I would like to be like, this is my country,
sure.
this is my government, I don't want people from other, like we have people from other countries that come here to work, and we're not in that mindset. Like if we all get into that same mindset, like this is my country, I don't want people coming here from somewhere else buying places on the beach and having their privatized or
sure.
having another company is that, because Mexico sells everything, right?
Yeah, so I'm sorry, we're running out of time. So that's a long question. Let me try to be concise. Look, as I said, 97.5%, 96.5% of human beings are great human beings. Not just good, great human beings. Right? But there's two things that drive humanity, fear and love. And the majority of humanity is way over here because we're still stuck in systems that create structural violence that don't have those four strategies, right? Directed innovation, planned technology, shared values, inclusive justice. Just pulling out the shared values bucket and talking about itself, it's worthless. You need all four of those strategies and they all need to be rolled out in that way. Because opportunity, once you have opportunity, you accelerate that through technology. How you decide how technology works is directed by shared values. With shared values, then you can have an opportunity for inclusive justice. If you just start throwing values out there, which is what you're seeing, right? You're seeing people just talk about stuff. You just need technology, or you just need values. That's not true, and that was the point of this presentation. You need all four of those in a consecutive manner. When it comes directly to your question around can people change, I fundamentally believe that the majority of human beings are great, right? And you can rehardwire our brains, but it takes courage to talk to somebody who you see and you know. All of us have a loved one who has one of the archetypes that you're talking about. But most of us don't approach them, right? Most of us don't talk about it. That's just the crazy uncle, or my father who's the racist, right? Or my mother who doesn't want me to marry outside of my ethnicity, right? You have to communicate. It's up to us, right? The millennials, the Generation Z, to stand up, to come together, to connect, to communicate. If we don't, see, the thing is, we think that open minds breed open hearts. That's what technologists are trying to sell you, that open minds breed open hearts. It's the other way around. Open hearts are what breeds open minds. But now I gotta get out of here. Thank you all so much. Thank you, thank you. I'm gonna pull a Jason Silva. Let's do a picture right here. Group picture right here. Come on, hurry up, group picture. I'm gonna pull a Jason Silva. We need a photographer though. Photographer! Okay, how do we photo? There we go. On three, we all say, we still have video camera here? We still have video? On three, we're all going to say humans deserve better, okay? One, two, three. Humans deserve better. Woo! Thanks, guys.